On the build show today, we're going to show you all the detailed steps that it takes to install one of these beautiful Marvin multi-slide doors, including a few detailed tips and tricks and some best practice methods. On the build show today, we're going to give you all the inside scoop on how to install this giant Marvin multi-slide door. Now this door is pretty big. This is 10 foot tall, 15 foot wide. Now I've got with me today, Corey Klonch, the owner of Architectural Impressions. Corey,
hey, bud.
You and the crew did an amazing job on this install, and I'm hope that you don't mind us revealing a few of your secrets on this install. Now you could use this install tips that we're gonna talk about today really on any door, but this is really specifically talking about this Marvin multi-slide. So first, let's start at the very beginning. You've arrived and we've got just a rough opening. What are you guys looking for? What are you doing first?
Checking the roof opening for plumb level and square. Whether it's concrete or subfloor, we've really got to check the sill well to see what we're working with, know whether or not we're going to need to trim down the subfloor, cut back the concrete, or potentially even pour up to make sure we've got a nice flush level surface.
Yeah, that makes sense. And then what's next after you've done that?
After we've done that, we're going to integrate the opening. So on this, we've got Polywalls Alumaflash, which is an asphalt product. We're going to wrap that all the way to the interior. That's critical to make sure we've got a good air barrier between the jam of the product and to the weather barrier on the outside. Integrate it into our pan, which in this case, we integrated up the wall prior to the door going in.
Yeah, no, so we're on an exterior porch here, Corey. We've got a big old giant 20-foot overhang. We've got a concrete porch here, which I understand is going to have a paver that's going to be flush with the door. And I like how you guys use the fluid applied. So this is actually Polywall's blue barrier to integrate the concrete curb to the wood subfloor. And then you've actually wrapped over top of that another layer of Alumaflash. Now, what happens with that Alumaflash though, where you hit the corners?
Well, because the Alumaflash can't flex like some of the other products, we ran it right into the corners, and then we use the blue barrier to integrate the corners, get it nice and tight so that when we stand up this gigantic frame, we're not scraping across it, and we've got a nice, tight, clean corner that's sealed.
Got it. Now, the next step, I understand, is to pull that sill out and check for level and get that sill nice and level all the way across. Now, 15 foot, that's a big opening. How are you doing that?
Well, a big part of it is once we lay the track down, we're going to check to see where our penetrations are going to go through the pan. On a large door like this and on large most multi-slides, we're going to have to penetrate the pan. Most manufacturers required us to fasten that sill through. So if you're using just a metal pan, you're penetrating the pan and your pan's basically worthless.
Right.
It's one of the reasons that we like to use a product like this. Lay it down so when the fasteners go through it, when they penetrate, they're going to self-seal through that asphalt membrane. And we're going to inject some sealant in there to seal it up. One of the ways that we like to make sure we get it nice, plumb level, or rather get it nice and level, is to use an airbag product. You can find a lot of them in big box stores. You can find them online. But we'll use that to get precision in our shimming so that we're not just cranking that threshold up and down trying to find level, but we can go really slow, get it right where we need to be, shim underneath it, and then screw it down tight. We check that by taking a 2x4 and sticking that 2x4 up against a laser level.
So the level's set on the outside so you can get the entire rough opening.
Yeah.
And it's set up a couple inches.
Absolutely.
And then what's the 2x4 doing for you?
Well, the 2x4 is just much easier to read than a measuring tape. I think most of the time and most of the ways that we were taught is you take the measuring tape and you lay it down and you try to read the same measurement across the dimension. You're constantly forgetting, what was that measurement that I started out with? So with a 2x4, you set the 2x4 down on what you would call your zero point, and then you make a line right underneath that laser line.
Nice.
And then as you move across, you can see your variance and then shim up back to your line where you know the laser line is touching your marked line, and you know that you're nice and level.
That's really smart. And you're going for how level all the way across there are you trying to get to?
At least a 16th inch over each foot.
Okay, gotcha. And maybe an eighth across the entire opening?
At least an eighth over across the entire opening.
Because you've got a door here. You don't want that door ghosting open on you.
No, you don't want it ghosting, and you've got to make sure you've got consistent shimming across the threshold, because with panels this large, that threshold's going to do that as you move the door across, and it's going to lead to that door being hard to open and close.
Okay, good deal. So now you've got the waterproofing all the way in, you've got your pan set, and you've gotten your level. What's the next step?
Well, the next step is we're going to assemble the frame. With the Marvin multi-slide product, we actually assemble the frame out of the opening and then stand it up in. Lots of benefits to that. It means that we can actually get really good sealant around the corners while the door frame's out of the opening and then standing it up in. Once the door frame's stood up, We're going to temporarily screw it in on both sides, mm-hmm. and then we're going to use a laser level to plumb level and square the entire frame, which is really the most critical part of this install.
And I notice you're using those stacking horseshoe shims right. so that you can really get everything nice and solid shimmed all the way across. Right. It looked to me like you've got no more than maybe 8 to 12 inches between solid shims all the way across that.
Absolutely. So. You're wanting to use the longest shims that you can find. However, on a really large track like this, sometimes it's hard to find shims that long, mm-hmm. or that's why it's really important to have access from both sides of the threshold so that you can get shims from both sides and get it nice and consistent.
And solid shimmed across there. That's smart. All right, so then walk me through how to stand up those door panels and what happens after that.
So you've got to be really careful standing the door panels up. Sometimes the best way is just a lot of strong
a
people.
Lot of muscle.
Yeah, and some suction cups and a lot of padding, standing the panels up. And to be quite honest, is the easiest part of this whole thing. Once the panels get in there, the rollers, I mean, the thing just glides like butter once it's in the frame.
And that's awesome. And then what's the final step on the inside? I noticed that you have some really good details in the back of the sill. Walk me through what you're doing there.
So on the interior, we have to do a consistent interior seal on the inside of the door. At the bottom, our first step is we use blue barrier to create an interior seal on the bottom of the threshold. Mm-hmm. And then we're setting in a rigid back dam into into that sealant. Screwing that to the subfloor, if this was concrete, we'd use a ram set or something like that to mm-hmm. put that down. Then we're covering it back up with a LumiFlash, primed, of course, into the opening to create a consistent seal along the backside of that rigid back dam, and then gooping the corners with the blue barrier to create a consistent seal on the backside of our pan.
I also noticed that you used your tool on the back of those too, so you're getting you're forcing that blue barrier in there. You've got a nice consistent seal on the bottom of the door. And really the last step is left to the builder to do the sealing at the jams and the head. Sometimes the insulation crew does that on my jobs. It's typically the finished carpenters that are going to come in and do that. Now you could do the traditional method, which is low expansion foam all the way around there. On a big door like that, I actually would probably start with that to get some insulation mm-hmm. value, but I'd prefer to finish it with a product like Prosco's Air Dam, right. Or maybe a good high quality DAP sealant, so we can get a really good air barrier on the inside of that jam. And at that point, we've got a door that's going to last a long time. This is a multiple generation door that's going to work and last for a long, long time. Any last tips or tricks or things that we missed, Corey?
That's really it. A lot of the tools that you saw in this video just make this thing so easy.
Yeah, for sure.
Really, the lifting is the hardest part at that point once you got the right tools.
I'll put a link in the description for all those kind of specialized tools between the laser and the air shim. So if you want to see those, there'll be an Amazon link for those. But Corey, big thanks to you and your crew. You guys did a great and very detailed install here. If you're in Austin and looking to buy some of these Marvin products, I highly recommend Corey and his company. There'll be a link for those guys. Also, big thanks to Marvin, who sponsors my videos and sponsored this. Great company. They make incredible products. Guys, if you're not a current subscriber, hit that subscribe button below. New content every Tuesday and Friday. Otherwise, we'll see you next time on The Build Show.